Welcome. So it's great to be here for this very, very special service. You can't hear me? Can't hear me? I never thought I wasn't loud enough. This is just something doesn't compute. Okay, so I'll welcome you again. I'll be louder this time. Welcome again to this very special service. Those of you here within the church and those of you on Zoom, it is a pleasure and a delight to welcome you this evening. There will be, after the end of the service, two wonderful things happening. And one of them is cake. Oh, I learned this past week, you only have to say cake and everyone acts like meerkats. What? Okay, however, so one of them is cake, and Lorraine has kindly brought one of her wonderful creations for us for this evening. Very many thanks to her. Also, okay, and also, once we have had the final blessing and prospectively the grace, then if you could stay in your seats, because our organist Lyndon Ford, who's joining us from the Royal Navy among many other places this evening, is going to play a piece that we understand was specially composed for our organ. It's a fantasia on our bells, so that's very much connected with this church. And as far as we know, it's never been played in public before. So this will be a first. So please stay behind. We don't rush off for a cup of tea. Stay behind to hear this piece that was specially composed for our organ. He's not here, but I will say it because I'm hoping, are you recording this for us for posterity? I'll say it because I also want to pay tribute to our organ builder, Daniel Spencer, and his assistant Toby, who have spent hours and hours and hours crawling around the organ to try and make it work. They have removed goodness knows how many pigeons and drained goodness knows how many gallons of water out of it. So they have made it sound as wonderful as it sounds today. There's still more work to be done, but we would want to make sure that they are credited for that. Without further ado, and you're pleased about that, we're going to start the service. There's going to be three songs to start off with, two of which the music group are going to play, and we'll all then join in the hymn, All My Hope in God Is Founded. Please feel free if you wish to and are able to stand. Thank you.
Let us worship God. We praise thee, O God, we acknowledge thee to be the Lord. All the earth doth worship thee, the Father everlasting. To thee all angels cry aloud, the heavens and all the powers therein. To thee cherubim and seraphim continually do cry, Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth, heaven and earth are full of the majesty of thy glory. Loving God, through Jesus Christ, you called us as you called your first disciples, and as you called all those 100 years ago to ministry and mission. We thank you for the Reverend Robert and Hetty Rowntree Clifford and all those who worked with them to faithfully build this magnificent building. We praise you for the inspiration you gave to all those who pioneered in those early days. And now we come after 100 years to offer ourselves to you in thanksgiving for the past, to praise you for today, and all this service that service has to offer us of praise, thanksgiving, and fellowship shared. Remind us that we now need to do our part in sustaining the life of this fellowship, that we might leave a fellowship of people who love and serve you with enthusiasm and dedication. Father, speak to each of us through your Holy Spirit, that we may be guided in all that we seek to do. Give us the words to say and the compassion we need, along with your strength, to work for your praise and glory. Help us to be strong for each other, to know your peace and your power in our lives. Above all, remind us of Jesus Christ, his willingness to endure the cross for our sake, his faithfulness to the end. Teach us what that really means, and by your grace, help us to respond and to be followers of your way, to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we share together in the words of confession, which will come onto the screen, which is on the screen. So as we say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. And we share together in the Lord's Prayer. You will find on the screen there is the traditional version, but please use whatever version you like, and in whatever language you feel most comfortable with. So we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. While we're all together, is there anyone here who wants to bring any kind of greeting to the service?
Hello, Church. I bring greetings from Colin and Pauline Waller. Colin was hoping to be with us. Colin used to do a lot of musical things in the church many years ago. But unfortunately, Pauline is very unwell these days. And I send greetings from Peter and Julia, who were on the way, but the cats had a little accident, so they send their love.
Anyone else? Yes? Come. Do you want to come forward or? so people can hear you better.
Well, good evening. I bring greetings from Custom House Baptist Church. We are your neighbors down the road, and I did say to them I was coming here this evening, and so they have said I should offer greetings. We look forward to joining together for the next 100 years, when I'll be long gone, I think. So they do wish you well, and we look forward to working together sometime in the future. God bless.
Thank you. Please come.
I bring you greetings from the parish of Plaster, which consists of St. Philip over in Whitwell Road and St. James and St. Mary's over off of Stockwell Road. It's always a joy when a church have been able to stay in fellowship, and in your case, you've been able to do it for over 100 years. And we say, to God be the glory, great things he has done. And you have done great to have your ministry, your missionary work continue over here. I'm getting used to Reverend Andrew, but I knew Mark because Mark and I work among the schools in this area through the Faith in School program. I'm hoping that I'll continue that and we draft in Reverend Andrew subsequently. But for the people over at St. Philip, St. James, and St. Mary's, I bring you my sincere greetings and pray that God will continue to bless you in all the work that you're doing, and may you win many souls for him. Thank you.
Thank you. Come on, Jane.
I bring greetings from Plaster Christian Fellowship, PCF. We meet next door in the Swift there, and we are grateful for the welcome and the hospitality that we have always received from this church. Thank you. And we're also grateful for the opportunity to work together for the gospel in this area. God bless you.
Good evening. We also bring greetings from PCEA UK Outreach. And most of you know that we meet here in the afternoon. And most of them were not able to be with us, but they sent me with the greetings and saying they are very grateful for the way you have welcomed them here and made them part of you, even as we do mission together in this area. And we are thanking God together with you as you celebrate 100 years of mission work. God bless you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I bring greetings from NICC, which is New Living International Christian Center. We worship upstairs. I really want to thank the Memorial Community Church for opening its doors, not only to us, but to many other congregations in the area who would not have had the opportunity to find a place, a good place to worship. I thank you for your friendship, your companionship, and the love you continue to show all of us that use your building and are part of God's mission to the world. God bless you, and I pray for many more successful years, because the Bible says that God will not forget the love that we have shown him as we continue to help his people, and the Lord will reward you abundantly in Jesus' name. God bless you all. Thank you.
I think perhaps we should give a round of applause to all those who support you. Now I'm going to hand over to Clive. I can see, he's there. He's going to come and introduce the next bit.
We're going to try with some visual aids to give a picture of a few incidents over the last 100 years. Now, the first of these starts only about 15 years ago, and George and Eliana and Adi, I think, are going to come up here and, well, can you some of you will recognise what this is referring to.
Hello, children. Hello, church. All right, I've been asked to bring some. My name is Shay. I've been worshiping here since 1998, I think. So I've been asked to bring some reflection based on the chair that has just been brought forward, because that ideally will stimulate my remembrance of what happened when the two churches merged. I started with Custom Baptist Church, and then I was going home across and I saw this church and I thought, oh, this was closer. So I started coming here. And I'm Baptist by background, so it all worked very well for me. At the time we were merging, what I can remember clearly was that the merger was God sent. Because it was a time that a lot of people were moving away from Newham, and the church membership was a bit low. And if you, from my accent, you know that I come from Nigeria, where churches are full and thousands, so some of us were feeling it. And just at that time, St. Andrew's lost their building, and we had this process where we were discussing merging. We attended services there, they attended here. We were all clear that our services were similar, and obviously we are all servants of God. So the decision was made that we would merge. So I remember that we used to have those beautiful chairs, the typical traditional pews, yes, and the black chairs here. And then we decided that since we were merging, we would get modern. And we brought these new chairs here. It changed a lot of things, and it's easier to manage as well. So the population grew. The leadership, because obviously we had leaders in Baptist Church and leaders from St. Andrews, they were able to, you know, very slick in terms of integration, because you have leaders from both churches. I remember a few people who were always imprinted on my mind. I remember Steve Acott with his singing attributes. A lot of things change, and this chair will always remind you of that. Our songs used to be typical Baptist hymns, you know, the Baptist hymnal book. That's what we used to use, and then we started changing and introducing other kinds of songs. I think that should be enough. I don't want to bore you. Yes. Thank you, guys.
You have to imagine in your mind's eye a whole crocodile of George and Eliana's walking down the Barking Road carrying chairs, and everybody else looking on and thinking, what's going on? Anyway, over to you. Now, shall we bring this down a little bit?
Yep, you're okay. This is a picture of a lady who was part of this church 100 years ago. Her name was Hilda Swift, and she made two special gifts to the church. The first gift was a gift of money, which was used to build the Swift Centre, the building next door to the church. The Swift Hall of Youth, as it was originally called, was to be a place for children and young people to make friends, to play, to learn, to study, to enjoy outings and to plan adventures. So a lot of things. Almost 100 years later, this was still being done by the BB and GB and the Youth Club. The second gift is a bit more difficult. Does anyone know what it is?
So, you've learned that the first gift was the Swift Centre, but there was a special thing inside the Swift Centre. That, Yvonne there.
Do you think it's the window in Swift?
Yes, she did commission a stained glass window that shows scenes from A Pilgrim's Progress, and this is in the former library of the centre. It was made by a famous artist in stained glass called Christopher Webb. If you want to see them, then you have to look at the photos in the exhibition.
So if you want to see it, thanks very much. Now, we're going to a special screen now, I think. Before that, all right, there's a special screen. Now, if we were being boring, and just like everybody else, we'd be showing you pictures of tents and children running around and enjoying themselves. But that would deprive you of the opportunity to think about this in your imagination. So picture a beautiful country scene. Now, it can be in Dorset, or Devon, or Cornwall, or Sussex, or anywhere in East Anglia, because that's all the places we went to. And in that field, there are a group of rowdy young people from East London who are lowering the tone of the area. And at various times, staying under canvas in those old-fashioned, heavy, green tents that you sort of imagine that the army used in 1893. That's not the only thing that was like the army in 1893, but it was one of them. Now, at various times in history, Colin, who's already been mentioned today, Colin and his wife Pauline, and then Anne and Nigel, and Charlie and Mavis, and latterly, a team with Mark, Jane, Jill and myself all led those camps. And I asked Anne and Nigel if one of them would just be willing to say for a very short time, that's it, in less than a minute, something about what was so special about those camps. And Anne has said, Nigel will do it.
Well, I have to say, first of all, it's a long time, many years, since I've stood here and surveyed my captive audience. Camp. What happened at Camp 5? I can't remember. I remember it being wet a lot of times, and I remember having to dig trenches around the marquee when the farmer said no, so we saved the field. But inspection was the best time of the day, wasn't it, Karen? So we used to have, 40 or 50 kids at some camps, plus staff, a lot of people. And we would pick a lorry up, park it at the front of the Swift, or the Hall of Youth, whichever era you worshipped in, and we would load this lorry, and one or two of us, who are still here, used to drive the lorry. And sometimes you knew when you'd loaded it, and you knew when other people had loaded it. Because as you'd go around the corner, it would go around the corner and you'd think, ooh, don't like this. But camp was great. I mean, all the kids loved it. And My first camp was in 1973, and my last camp was in 2002. So it was around about the 30-year mark. And you may not recognise me because I haven't got my shorts on. And I do apologise, Yvonne, but, you know, I thought I probably ought to put some trousers or jeans on at least for tonight. But yeah, camp was brilliant. It was a wonderful experience, and I loved it. And I'm sure that everybody else that went to camp loved it too. And I'm sure that when I left, and I know from my own children who carried on going to camp, and I heard some of the stories, that they enjoyed it too. So thank you.
It was Nigel that conned me, sorry, I mean convinced me, to start coming to camp as a leader in the very early 1990s. And when I said there were a number of things about camp that were reminiscent of the army in 1893, we finished our camp with a bugle call. And we're just going to play that now.
Clive. I hope you don't mind. I'd like to add one more thing about Miss Swift. That's her piano. And that would have been played on the opening Sunday 100 years ago because we didn't have the organ then. So an extra bit of history. So we come to our next hymn, which is Great is Thy Faithfulness. And during this hymn, we will take up an offering. This is a free will offering. Don't feel that you're obliged to put money into the basket. Just let it pass you by. God our Father, we bring our gifts of money, and together with them we bring ourselves, that together we might be used for the extension of your kingdom and the proclaiming of your gospel, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We have a Bible reading, but I don't know who's doing that reading. It's Jill. Okay, Jill. It's from John chapter 8 and verse 12.
John chapter 8 and verse 12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life."
Thank you very much, Jill, for that reading. And thank you very much to everybody so far. And we sincerely hope that you're enjoying our centenary celebration. It's marking 100 years of this building, which is now known as Memorial Community Church. And what a lovely coincidence that it is in this same year that we are blessed with a new minister, a person many of you have come to know so well in the space of just 9 months. Since he assumed his post. He's already made his way to the pulpit, so may I invite our own Reverend Andrew Alcock to take the pulpit this evening for the first time in many, many, many years. I'm sure at least not in the last 16 years that I've worshipped in this building. He will be bringing the centenary message to us this evening. So Andrew.
So the people on Zoom should now be able to hear me and see me. Do we believe that to be working? We believe it to be working. Fantastic. Okay. All right, so Lord, may the words that I am to speak now may be the words you need us all to hear at this time in your blessed and holy name. Amen. Okay. Those of you who have been paying attention will recognize this evening's reading as our verse for the year. 1, 3, 4 people nodding. Excellent. Okay, that's fantastic. And I realized as I put together the orders of service for the remaining part of the year, we'd pretty well gone through the whole year and not mentioned at all the verse for the year. So what better opportunity than on this centenary service? Now, a warning for you, or a heads up, or however you so term it, quite a lot of what I'm going to say, I have said before here in this church. Now, there could very well be one of two reactions to me saying that. First of which will be, oh my heavens, is this a test and we should have been listening? And the second one is, he's been here 9 months, he's already run out of things to say. And maybe both of them are partly true. But let's get into the text that we actually have. And the first thing you're going to get or recognize is a little bit of a moan. Don't do that very much. I can see you all around. I've such a good view from up here. I can see all your reactions. The first thing is a moan, that actually the passage is so short. It is such a short passage. In fact, the scripture writers never really intended for just one verse to be taken out and for us to look at. They crafted what they were putting together so we'll get a fuller picture. And sometimes here in church, we just have short passages like we have this evening, or just our favorite parable, and we don't set it in context. And sometimes, much to our shame, Christians take a single verse out of context and will use it as a weapon against other Christians. So my first moan is, maybe the passage is a bit short for this evening, but then you're looking at me going, you picked it, sunshine. Right, those of you who were paying attention just about 30 seconds ago when I said you've heard some of this before, probably now know what's coming next. Blank looks, fantastic. Okay, it's from John's Gospel. Seeing if any light bulbs are coming on. Oh, 4, 5, 7 light bulbs, fantastic. John's Gospel, one of those fantastic works that I've only recently got to love within the scripture. When I were a lad, and I were a choir boy, not 100 years ago, but yeah, okay. I used to think John's Gospel were right boring. John's Gospel were right boring because we went straight into those occasions when Jesus is faced with the enthusiasm of his disciples. And he sort of pours cold water on it, going, yeah, but verily I say to you. And they're so enthusiastic, and he rains on their parade so much. And the reason I didn't like John's Gospel in those days was because I didn't do that which you are supposed to do when you go to John's Gospel, and who knows what I'm going to say next now. Ah, go to the prologue. Go to the prologue. When John wrote his Gospel, it wasn't to have bits and pieces cherry-picked, much as they're wonderful, and this evening's verse is splendid, which is why, of course, we picked it for our verse for the year. You have to unlock what's going on. Many, many years ago, I thought I would get a bit of culture. I know it doesn't show, but hey-ho. And I thought I'd get a bit of culture, and I would read classic Gothic horror. I mean, the proper versions. So the proper Bram Stoker's Dracula and the proper Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. I do recommend, actually, as a Christian preacher, I do recommend Frankenstein. It is a very, very good book. And it's not like anything you have seen in the cinemas or the television screen. And it's certainly not like Carry On Screaming. However, three people have seen Carry On Screaming, showing my age. Bram Stoker's Dracula, however, I could barely get through, because he wrote it so that we, the readers, knew more about what was going on than the characters themselves. Oh dear, this poor girl has no blood left. How about that? I wonder what caused that. And it was really frustrating. However, more successfully, John, the writer of the Gospel, lets us into the secret of what's going on so that instead of getting bored, we get excited when we go through the Gospel. Again, we know more than the characters. Why? Because we started at the beginning, the prologue, the bit you're going to hear on Christmas Eve. Yes, you are. Right at the end of the carol service. At the carol service there, Lyndon. Just wondering. Diary session afterwards. Right at the end of the carol service. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We have, right from the beginning of John's Gospel, an understanding that this character he's about to introduce, that we then find out is Jesus, is God. There is no doubt about it. And if you ever have, you've heard this one before, you're going, oh yeah, it's about St. Jehovah's Witnesses. Yes, he is. If you happen to have people who don't believe Jesus is God come to the door, as they do, point them in the direction of their own Bibles, where it says very clearly, Jesus is God. And throughout John's Gospel, he shows us as Jesus as both God and human. In Jesus' actions, he is a good Jewish man. More than the other Gospels, he's constantly going to the temple for the festival of this or that. He's doing what a good Jewish man would do. And in the background, we still know that he is still God. That's what we get from the prologue. Don't go near John's Gospel without coming in the front door, because you could find yourself confused or bored. Who thinks they know what the next thing is I'm going to say? Again, is it a test or has he run out of things to say? Very, very blank looks. Even more than normal. Oh, there we go. It's, you ready for this? It's an I am saying. People going, I should remember him talking about this. Throughout John's Gospel, you will recognize Jesus saying outrageous things about himself. And this is one of those sayings. I am the light of the world. What? Another one, I am the bread of life. What? One we had just a few weeks ago when we had the memorial service in here. I am the way, the truth, and the life. These are known for those people who study Greek much more than I ever did at college as the ego eimi sayings, I am. And they cause us to puzzle about the person God. Remember, we're in John's Gospel. We already know, because we've been good readers, started from scratch, and we know that Jesus is God. So what happens when we get to these very special sayings? Now, cast your minds back into the Old Testament. Right back to when Moses was faced with a burning bush. And Moses is given this, what? You can't be serious task of going down into Egypt, confronting the most powerful king who ever lived at that point, and demanding the release of an entire nation. And Moses goes, yeah, probably need someone else. And anyway, who am I supposed to say has sent me? And at that point, God reveals his own name. Now, in Hebrew, anyone here speak Hebrew better than I do, which means any at all? Good, okay. In Hebrew, it sounds a lot like Yahweh. But what it actually means is, I am. And if it exists, then it's me. I am. We understand God's name to be I am. So when Jesus then says, I am, we all get excited, don't we? We already know that John is pointing in the direction of saying Jesus is God, and it seems as though Jesus is confirming it. Now, let's be serious. When Jesus says, I am going to the shops, he's not claiming to be God. But when he says something like, I am the bread of life, or I am the light of the world, little alarm bells. Is this where Jesus claims to be God? No. After all that, no, it isn't quite. But it's where John points us in the direction of this. Jesus isn't saying, I am, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, look whose name I'm talking about, because that's far too simple. And it's not really where Jesus is at. Remember, he usually refers to himself as the Son of Man. However, John particularly points it out to us. John points it out by saying, here is Jesus, the person we know to be both human and divine. Here is Jesus claiming to be something only God can be. Only God can be the Good Shepherd. Only God can be the way, the truth, and the life. Only God can be the light of the world. Jesus isn't claiming the divine name for himself, but John is pointing us and Jesus and saying, here, in this person, is a being only God can be. Effectively saying the same thing. So then we get to tonight's reading. You're going, it's been going half hour, we haven't started yet. Tonight's reading is one of those verses we know so well. It's been on the notice board for most of last year as well. But what do we mean when Jesus says of himself and also of God, I am the light of the world? What does he mean by that? Right, lights to us are really easy, aren't they? You flick a switch, they turn on. We've all got one of these in our pockets, haven't we? In fact, this morning we used them. You press a button and a light comes on. Light to us is something of no effort. It's just automatically there. Sometimes we're a bit decorative with them, as we have been with the cross lights. But if we go back to first century Palestine, light meant much more than pressing a button on your smartphone. This is something that has been made, crafted, to provide warmth and direction and comfort. Not something, a torch, that we carry in our pocket all the time. I am the light of the world isn't something that means I'm carried around in your pocket and only picked out when you need me. It's something that is being crafted and provides comfort, direction. Only God can be that. So Jesus is claiming for himself one of the aspects of God. This is another way by which Jesus announces to us his own divinity alongside the signs that John gives us elsewhere in the gospel. Think for a moment about what light might mean. Not just the flicking on LEDs that we have all over the place now, but what light might mean if you are lost in the darkness. Happened to me many moons ago, and I'm sure I've told the story before, and you're not going to stop me because I'm right up here, okay? When I was sailing across the North Sea with a friend of mine who's now sadly died, we're in a very, very small boat in a very, very big storm, and pretty sure where we were. But we became a lot more sure when, as we reached the top of the wave and we could see a bit more of the horizon, we saw the lighthouse we're aiming for. Just to be clear, we aimed to go past the lighthouse, not at the lighthouse, because that's where the rocks were. But it provided everything I have just said. As we were really, really, really scared, because we'd never sailed that boat in that type of storm before, as we were really scared, as we reached the top of a wave and saw the light, we got guidance and comfort. Guidance and comfort. So that's what Jesus is saying he is. God is. And we could finish it there. And that would be fantastic. Jesus, the light of the world, guidance and comfort. Very good, Andrew. Go, we've got cake to have in a few minutes' time. No, there's a bit more. And again, this is another bit that those of you who come here frequently will have heard. It's something to do with this building. Oh, at last. It's something to do with this building and how those who put this building, those who had the vision for this building, wanted to make it a place of guidance and comfort. If we think about how the area might very well have been, and if we look back at the pictures in the wonderful exhibition in the gallery up the stairs, which you're going to see in a minute, okay? Think about the East End when this place was put up. Would it not provide for guidance and comfort? Because those who founded this building the Roundtree Cliffords, and all the people who put the vision together that we benefit from today. They had an understanding that they were following in Jesus' footsteps. Can you tell where I'm going with this one? To call ourselves followers of Jesus is not to be Jesus' cheerleaders. Ah, yes, moments of recognition on a few people's faces. He said that four times already this year. There'll be more. To be followers of Jesus is not to be a cheerleader of Jesus. I mean, we are. We come and we praise and we say to other people, you want to know this Jesus because Jesus brings us comfort and guidance. Say, how about that? But we follow Jesus in the way that in the Navy we talk about handing over, having handover notes. The Bible is handover notes. Jesus, the man who is God, provided for the world comfort and guidance as a pattern for us to follow. As a pattern for us to follow. And as we celebrate 100 years of this fantastic, beautifully put together, crumbling building, expensive, but wonderful building, we recognize in those who put it together 100 years ago, their understanding of being followers of Christ, not being cheerleaders of Christ, but providing comfort and guidance for all the local area. So if you hadn't guessed it yet, if you hadn't second-guessed any of what I was about to say, which I hope you have, because I've said most of it a few times before, but anyway, the next bit is obvious. This centenary isn't when it stops, he says, hopefully. The plaster came down earlier. This centenary isn't when it stops. It's when the baton is passed to us from both our predecessors who put this building together and had the vision for mission in this area, and Christ himself. We are the ones for whom other people should be able to say, they are a light. They provide guidance and comfort and point us to the reality of the love of God.
Thank you very much, Reverend Andrew. We are indeed blessed by your message. We will now have our next hymn with it. The honor of your name here in Memorial Community Church and in all churches across Newham, across London, and indeed all of the UK. Please, I invite you to rise to your feet if you're able. Let us join in singing this honoring hymn to our God, a song by Graham Hendrick, Restore, O Lord.
Restore, O Lord, the honor.
Please do be seated. As we have our own dear Pastor Jeremy, who will come to lead us in our prayers this evening.
And so we turn to God in prayer now. Lord, as we celebrate today the first 100 years of this building, we remember with thanks the amazing faith and organisation of those who had the original vision for this building and its ministry. For this building, used to the sound of singing, this building which has seen baptisms and funerals, this building where people have come to be married or to celebrate the birth of a child, this building where people have wept and been filled with joy, this building where people have wrestled with the deep things of life, have prayed urgently, been stirred and changed. This building which has shared its facilities with other churches and organizations. This building where people have been fed and been cared about. In this building where you have so often been with your people, be with us now, light of the world. As we enter the second century in this building, we pray for your blessing on the minister, leaders, and members of the church, that we may be faithful to Jesus in word and deed, that we have a vision for this building and have the resources needed to serve others, that we have the unity, perseverance, and wisdom to find solutions to challenges. We pray for the welfare of the city, for the local community in its needs and potential, for family, friends, and neighbors, for young and old, for the vulnerable, lonely, and isolated, for community leaders and for local and national government, for justice and peace among nations. We pray that this building may be a place of comfort and guidance, a place to find peace, healing, and friendship, a place of faith, hope, and love, a place of welcome, forgiveness, and grace, a place of joy, a place of mission and service, a place of prayer and renewal by your Spirit, a place and a community to the glory of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Pastor Jeremy, for leading us in our prayers this evening. Our final hymn tonight, which gently leads us to the end of this centenary service, was first written in 1967 as a special occasion hymn, just like we are having here for the centenary celebration of the CSSM. That is the Children's Special Service Mission, founded in 1867, and which was later taken under the wings of what is more popularly known today as Scripture Union, or the SU. So please, let me invite you once again to stand if you're able, and if you're okay to do so, as we join together in loudly proclaiming in song, Lord, for the years your love has kept and guided. We stand.
So now may the blessing of God who created us, God the Son who redeemed us, and God the Holy Spirit who inspired those over 100 years and continues to inspire and guide us now, be with us this evening, into the coming week, and for eternity. Amen.
Amen.